Thanks, guys. All right. It gets a bit scary now, doesn't it? Hey, good evening, everyone. So I had big plans for this presentation tonight, complete with childlike imaginings of delivering some kind of inspirational TED-style talk, you know, that would change the world. But the problem is, due to an acquired brain disease, inside my head actually looks a bit like this. It makes standing here doing this really quite difficult. It's definitely a long way from where you'd usually find me, sitting by the rivulet, immersed in the world of the platypus. So apologies in advance if things get awkward. If I completely blank out or start to cry, high chance of crying tonight, I might just need a moment to regroup along the way. Because you see, the thing is, I'm compelled to tell this story on behalf of my monitoring buddies. It's a meandering story, much like a waterway. It's a story of the things I've seen, the things I've thought, and some of the things I've learned during this time spent with the platypus. So pass the Kleenex, sit back, and enjoy the show.
Comfy Perry the Platypus, I've prepared something special just for you. You see, until now, every attempt to eradicate you has been foiled. Then I came across some... Excuse me, who are you and what are you doing here?
I bought a ticket to see this movie.
Okay, just roll the film.
Who is the enemy of the platypuses? Or platypi, or platypeople? Well, you know what I mean. The platypus is one of our greatest friends in nature, a humble but key component in Mother Nature's delicate cycle of life. But as of late, worldwide populations have been declining to near endangerment. But why? Who is the enemy of the platypuses? Or, well, you know what I mean.
This is the best platypus movie I have ever seen.
But there is a new enemy of the platypus, one whose tireless development paves over the platypus's woodland homes. The greatest enemy of the platypus is man.
So are we the greatest enemy of the platypus? And if we are we okay with that being our story? Sadly, Australia's treatment of the natural world continues to make news for all the wrong reasons. But I know what you're thinking, fellow Taswegians, as you look at those headlines. Mainlanders. Look at what they've done over there. It could never happen here. We celebrate the natural world in Tasmania. At least that's what our license plates say. And at the very least, out of self-interest, we should care for it, as our natural world in Tassie bankrolls the way of life we so enjoy. Surely of all the places in Australia, we would never let our life-sustaining waterways degrade into little more than drains, right? So I guess the good news is, relative to the mainland, Tasmania is still thought to be a stronghold of the platypus. But a more accurate view is that due to a lack of data and monitoring, we really don't know. Amongst other things, the 2010 management plan also recommended short-term actions that could be implemented immediately. Clean up rubbish along waterways, or prevent it entering waterways. A simple and important step. So let's fast forward a decade to 2020. It was 6:34 p.m. actually on October 21st. I came across a platypus in the Hobart Rivulet with a plastic ring entangled around its bill. A platypus that would become affectionately known as Zoom. So helpless at the time, all I could do was watch and hope, as this scenario often leads to a slow and painful death. It was a pivotal moment. I began to look at the waterway through new eyes, not through the eyes of someone strolling or cycling along the rivulet, enjoying the picturesque view, but through the eyes of the natural world. It wasn't good. I started collecting rubbish lying in and around the waterway. It felt pointless at times, as more rubbish would soon take its place. I began to notice the many stormwater drains that empty into the rivulet, along with frequent odorous discharges. Along the length of the rivulet, residents began sharing their stories with me, stories that spanned decades, stories of platypus, stories of pollution. I could go on, but you get the picture. So how is it the way we think we live is so different the effect our lives have on the natural world? And whose fault is this square-shaped mess we find ourselves in anyway? Well, for starters, I'm as much to blame as anyone. I've lived an affluent, adventurous, and secure life, living in some of Australia's most beautiful places. I couldn't even guess at how many things I've taken along the way. Zillions of photos, memories, and more. It's there for all to see. Endless images, a huge amount of resources consumed in the name of fun. It turns out I wasn't okay with my story anymore. Enter my platypus teachers. They've taught me that enjoying nature is not the same as caring for nature. Enjoying nature is easy, like fresh donut Fridays at work. And I should know, it's been my life's work to sample donuts across the city. Hiking, climbing, riding, paddling, travelling, taking endless photos and so on. I began to wonder, what had I personally given back to the natural world that had made these adventures possible? And seen in isolation, were they anything more than another form of consumption? On the other hand, I've learned that caring for the natural world is not easy. Caring means lying awake at night, dreading what you might learn the next day. Caring means giving things up. It means doing things you'd rather not. Endless meetings, emails, phone calls. But caring also means giving back. So you might be rolling your eyes right now thinking, not another placard-bearing, sticker-wearing South Hobartian who is out to save the world. So I'll set my own bar at a realistically low level. Firstly, historically, humans have been in the business of harming, not saving. We know harm. It turns out we're quite good at harm, harming each other, the natural world, and every other living creature that stands in the way of our lifestyle. So as you'd expect, our resume for position of saviour of the natural world isn't looking too flash. Secondly, without our assistance, platypus have adapted, evolved, and survived for millions of years, remaining in perfect balance with their environment. Like the natural world, they don't need another wannabe saviour. They just need us to do less harm. They need us to give back and to care. The good news is, despite everything, fortunately, amazingly, platypus currently still survive in our local urban waterways. I'd like to share with you a few moments from time spent with the platypus. Firstly, foraging. Imagine you're hungry, really hungry. Little parcels of food are hidden throughout the city and you have to find them to survive. Except you have to find them with your eyes closed, your ears closed, while holding your breath. Imagine if that went on for 12 to 16 hours every single day. It sounds impossible, but the platypus make foraging look easy. Seeing that clip. So this is on the surface feeding. Apart from being genius underwater eating machines, what else do our urban platypus get up to? Lots, as it turns out. The first thing you might see a platypus doing, other than foraging, is grooming. I love that last one. You might also be lucky enough to see a platypus do a poo. Up until recently, it was assumed platypus rarely defecate out of the water. But it turns out, at least in Hobart, they often poo on land, typically around the edge of a pond, as if to say, hey, this is my territory. This up-and-coming young male platypus, I call Junior, has even taken to pooing right beside me, just to make a point. So I've actually got poo in my freezer at home, platypus poo, of course. The other awesome thing about that behaviour is that when you're walking along a waterway, you know, you can look out for scats, and the age of the scat kind of gives you a clue as to, you know, if there's a platypus around or not. Yeah. Impressively, platypus are strong, determined and capable climbers. I've often come across an obstacle in the waterway, like a large sort of waterfall, and thought there's just no way this tiny, crazy little animal can make it up, you know, that face. And then I've sat and waited and returned and sat and waited some more. And finally the platypus comes along and it just makes it look easy. And in-flight snacks are always included. So concrete is the natural urban enemy of the platypus. Man-made structures that disrupt water flow and fragment populations pose a significant threat to the platypus, and the animal knows it. Unfortunately, these structures are all too common in our urban environment, yet platypus adapt. But as we know, there has to be a point of no return. Thank you. Last year, the local platypuses began to gather with increasing intensity. I'd be observing one platypus, and out of the blue, another two would suddenly whiz past and drop into the pond in front of me, connected nose to tail. It took me a while to realise the courting and mating season had begun.
My darling, I can't get enough of your love, babe. Girl, I don't know why. Can't get enough of your love, babe. Lord, some things I can't get used to. No matter how I try. It's like the more you give, the more I want. And baby, that's no lie. Oh no, babe. Tell me, what can I say? What am I gonna do? How should I feel with everything in you? What kind of love is this that you're giving me? Is it in your kiss or just because you're sweet? Girl, all I know is every time you're here, I feel a change.
It is really such a beautiful dance, you know, when you see it happening in front of your own eyes. So being able to witness all of these behaviours in an intimate setting has been a joy and a privilege. But really the core of this story is, excuse me for a minute, is one of connection. For whatever reason, I've been welcomed into the usually elusive world of the platypus. Once comfortable with your presence, platypus will often approach, wiggle their bill in the air, pushing forwards as if to say, hey, you're back. Don't you actually have a home? You seem all right, but what are you made of anyway? Any update on the future of our waterway? But maybe along the way, all they've been saying is, you really need to wash those clothes, Pete. You smell like a swamp rat. It's a connection that can't be explained, but one I'm deeply grateful for and yearned for when back in the land of humans. So how does the story of our very own animal of all time, the Hobart Rivulet Platypus, end? Give me a sec. Yeah. So much like our own story, for now at least, the pen remains in our hands. We live in an ever-growing city built in the foothills of a mountain within the catchment area of a fragile waterway. We all look to the future with concern. It's a pickle, as they say. But does that mean we can't embrace and care for what natural world remains and the creatures that call it home? outside of our houses, around the corner, down the street, in our own rivulet. Thank you for your time and support this evening. Take it away, Perry the Platypus.
Thank you, Peter. I've been meaning to stack those chairs.
Dr. Doofenshmirtz, tell Perry the Platypus how you feel.
Perry the Platypus, I'm so sorry I hurt you. When I wasn't actually trying to hurt you. If you give me another chance, I promise to hurt you in the right way. With cartoonish physical violence and elaborate traps constructed out of strange things I've purchased over the internet. What do you say?
Well, what do you say, Perry the Platypus?
Oh, thank you, Perry the Platypus. Now! I can't believe that worked!